The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Hello all. Thanks for being here. I'm Yash Bharadwaj, and along with me we have Manish Gupta. So we both will be presenting a small webinar on the topic hybrid multi-cloud red team training that we are launching. So today we will discuss about all the points, like what all things are included in the training, the training outline we have, and the subscription plans that is included in this particular training, like the community edition we have free for the users, and also the premium edition that includes lab. All these things will be discussed in the later sections in the training, and later on we will also provide you the insights of the introduction to this hybrid multi-cloud red teaming, like how it is done. So the technical details and all these things will be provided us with us by when we progress through this webinar. So over to you. Thanks for being here. So we will be starting just in a minute. Let a few of the attendees join too, and then we will start. So if anyone have any questions, feel free to put in the chat box. And in the end, we will have around 10 to 15 minutes for the doubt clearing session. So please feel free to ask any questions, like for 5 to 10 minutes, we will be here for you. So over to you, Manisha.
Thanks, Yash. So we are just supposed to begin in 2 minutes. We'll wait for 4 more participants to join. So this will be the agenda of our this webinar. I think we can start now. So first of all, thank you so much for joining this session. So agenda behind this webinar is to give introductions about how you can perform a red team operations on hybrid multi-cloud environment. So generally what happened, most of the organizations are using multi-cloud as well as on-premises for their infrastructure, their applications, for their users and authentications and all these things. But for as red teamers, how they can perform a red team operations? Because when you're talking about the multi-cloud environment, mainly we are using the three most demanding cloud provider like AWS, Azure, and GCP, as well as on-premises setup like Active Directory environment. But when it comes to red teaming activities, it's very difficult for a red teamers to understand about all the three, you know, cloud providers, their working styles, and where the organization hosted what kind of, you know, data is there. So that this seminar will give you a basic idea about as a red teamer, how you can approach for each and every cloud vendor and how you can do the red team operations there. So this will be the agenda. First, we'll give the introductions about all the three vendors, how the organization from top view it's look like, or from a red team perspective, how a red teamers think about performing a red team operation when they are coming into a, you know, hybrid multi-cloud things. Then we'll see how we can authenticate. So suppose if you have a... Suppose if you have a multi-cloud, you know, there in your environment, and how you can authenticate to each and every cloud. Is there any IAM role or is there any federation identities involved in this particular thing? So we'll discuss about how you can access all the cloud vendors from portal, from GUI, from APIs, from SDK, and all of these things. Then we'll discuss about the training that we have. So recently we introduced a training for hybrid multi-cloud, which is also free of cost for the training. So you can enroll this training and you can get an idea about to performing these operations. And then we have set up a lab. So basically lab is look like a real world environment of a organizations. They are using you know, different services of different cloud vendors. And your main motive is to compromise each and every cloud vendor along with their on-premises to compromise or to achieve your objective. And at the end, we will discuss about the question answer session. If you have any query questions, please feel free to ask. We will, you know, follow your questions. So let's start. Okay. So the first thing that we are going to discuss here is the introductions about hybrid multi-cloud environment. Why it's really important to understand about each and every cloud vendors, their authentication, authorization mechanism, how and what kind of services most of the organizations are, you know, basically migrate from on-premises to their cloud, how we can authenticate, and from a red team perspective, how you can approach, how you can enumerate, and how you can perform a different kind of attack. And at the end, how you can literally move from one cloud to another cloud, and from cloud to on-premises, as well as on-premises to cloud environment. So that is really important. So let's start with one thing. The first thing is when you're talking about hybrid multi-cloud, is basically combination of, as of now, here we are discussing about AWS, Azure, and GCP as a cloud vendors. Mainly, you know, these are the three most popular cloud vendors here. And the fourth one is the on-premises environment, because a lot of organizations are still also using the, you know, Active Directory environment or any sort of, you know, on-premises environment for their workload or for their applications. So when you're talking about hybrid multi-cloud, it's a combination of these three of the cloud vendors, and one is the on-premises. Then what is that basically difference and how we can approach for a red team perspective? So you can see here, this is the overview of perfect. So you can see here, this is the general architecture of on-premises, you know, environment. There may be, you know, different kind of firewalls, DNS server, mail server, which is traditionally most of organization, mainly banking, telecom sectors, they are using. Still, they are using this kind of, you know, architecture. So we heard that they are using a lot of Active Directory environment for authentication and for access management also in their on-premises setup. So this is a general overview of how an on-premises architecture look like. So we have a, suppose there are two kind of network. One is external network, one is internal network. External network are public facing. So you have a web server, you hosted your applications, you have your DNS mail server. So all these things comes into a, or we can say it's a DMZ zone, which is publicly exposed. So anybody from the public can access this particular network. And we do have an internal network. So employees who are working in this particular organization can access. So generally, we have an internal network, especially we have Active Directory environment for authentications or for access management. So this is the typical architectures look like. Now moving to the second slide. Okay. So when you're talking about Active Directory environment, because when you're talking about red teaming, Active Directory involve a lot when you're doing a red teaming on premises. So this is the typical, you know, we have a multiple domain. They are connected to each other. So suppose there is an ABC organization. They do have a separate domain, XYZ as well, and how they are communicate to each other. Why it's important? Suppose if you're part of one of the domains and you compromise the whole domain, how you can laterally move or how you can access the another domain which is also have a trust relationship with this one. So from a red team perspective, you may so there may be a multiple domain or trust will be there, or basically forest will be there. So how we can approach, how we can laterally move from one domain or one forest to another forest. So this is the typical architecture of Active Directory environment. So Active Directory is a part of internal network. When we're talking about internal network, there is a lot of things also involved and apart from Active Directory. But here we're focusing on Active Directory. This is just introductions. Now we're talking about multi-cloud architecture. So when you're talking about multi-cloud, most of the organizations, they are using AWS, Azure, and GCP for their applications, their workload, right? So first, let's discuss about AWS. How exactly it looks like from a red team perspective. So you can see here, I'm using AWS account. So you have your personal account, you can log in there, and you can do, you know, spawn a VM, you can store your data on the bucket. But when we're talking about organizations have hundreds of AWS accounts. How they are connected to each other, how we can enforce the policy, or from a red team perspective, how you can compromise one account to another account and then compromise the whole root account. So this is the structure it's look like. So you can see here. This is the main account or root account, and in root account we have hundreds of sub account which is connected to root account. So this is how the AWS organizations look like, and each and every organizations it have the same structures. They do have one root account, and they have hundreds of sub accounts. So all the accounts are connected to this root account. Now from a user's perspective, from a red team perspective, suppose if there are multiple accounts are there. Maybe a development account, productions account. How, if you have a part of one account only, how you can access the cross account? Because this is really important. If you form a red team, if you are doing a red team operations and you have access, you compromise one account. But how you think that you can access the another account which is part of this organization? So this is called a assume role methodology. Generally, if you want to laterally move from one account to another account, you have to assume the role and then you can access the second account which you do have a right. So this is a typical architecture look like. Suppose there is one identity you can see here. Yeah, you can see here, this is the identity here. And this identity is part of this development account. So this I have access on only this development account. This is part of this one. Now, if this identity want to access the resources or laterally move here, he can assume the role from this account and then he can access the, or he or she can access the, resource, which is, there in this production account. So this is done by assuming role technology. So AWS follow this method. If you have a part of one account and if you want to access a cross account data or cross account resources, you have to assume the role and then you can perform this. From a red team operation, we also follow the same way. If you laterally move from one account to another account, you have to perform this assume role methodology. So we have to check how, what kind of access I do have, how we can retrieve the temporary token, what kind of token we can have, and then how we can laterally move from one account to another account. Okay, next. Okay, so when you're talking about single account, Just now we talked about multiple accounts you have or cross account access we have, but when we're talking about single account, suppose you go you sign up for Azure AWS, you know, subscriptions, or and then you can see there so you can see there are multiple regions. So AWS is divided into a region, so each and every region we have a multiple, you know, resources, maybe VMs, bucket, or whatever resources we have. So AWS divided these things in a region, and each and every region we have multiple resources. So this is talking about the single account that we have. We'll already discuss how we can connect it to multiple account and how we can literally move from one account to another account. So this is a typical structure of each and every you know, organization they will follow if, when we're talking about they're using the AWS. Now what next? Azure. So when you're talking about Azure, you can see here. One second, I'm just going to do this. Okay. So when you're talking about Azure, there are three main components. One is Azure Active Directory. Second one is Azure ARM. And third one is Office 365. These are connected to each other. When we're talking about Azure Active Directory, this is used for authentication and authorization purpose. So they do have identity. So even if you're using Office 365, just like Exchange, OneDrive, or any kind of services, in the backend, they're using Azure AD for authentication. Similar kind of things when you spawn an instances in Azure, this comes into a Azure Resource Manager basically. And for the backend for authentication purpose, they are using Azure AD. So Azure AD is mainly used for authentication. So this is used for authentication. So either you can use Azure ARM or Office 365. Azure AD is used for authentication. So this is the working model of Azure have. But in AWS, everything is combined in a single place. So if you have account, authentication and authorization done by the single account only. But here we have three different components. Now what next? Okay. We already discussed how AWS, how we connected a multiple accounts to a single account in AWS when we have been talking about multiple accounts or cross account access. Similar kind of situations happen in Azure. AWS work on account level, but Azure works on multi-tenancy or tenancy level. So you can see here, I have one identity which can have access to multiple tenant. And each tenant have a subscriptions and all these things. But tenant is really important. When you're talking about AWS, account is important because I can access have a multiple account. Similar kind of things in Azure, I do have access on multiple tenant. In each and every organization, maybe they are using a multi-tenancy environment or they do have a multiple tenant for their, you know, workload or applications. So from a red team perspective, you should understand about, it's not your objective to compromise one tenant. Your objective to compromise whatever tenants they are using in this particular organization. They maybe use a two or three tenant and whatever resource is part of this particular tenant. So suppose you can see as a red teamers, you compromise one account and you can see what kind of access they do have on each and every tenant. And what are the tenants are there? So this is a multi-tenancy architecture look like. Now, when we're talking about single tenant, so suppose if you have if you compromise one account which is have a single tenant access, so this is how the structures look like. You do have access on tenant, then there will be a management group, then there will be subscriptions, and we have a resource group and then resources. So basically, when you say in short term how it's look like, you have a tenant and each or every tenant have multiple subscriptions. Subscription may be one subscription for development environment, other one is for staging, and third one is for production environment. Each subscription is basically used for billing purpose. And each and every subscription have a resources, maybe VMs, bucket, secret manager, or whatever resources we are using it. So why it's important, if you're performing a red team operations and you access one of the resources, your main motive is to, you know, escalate your privilege and to compromise whole tenant. And if you compromise the whole tenant, then you have, then you should know that what other tenants are there. So once you get to know about a different tenant, then you have to compromise the whatever tenant is comes to these organizations. So this is the one by one step you have to perform in that team operations to achieve our objective. Now, third one is GCP. We already discussed about AWS, which is worked on account level. So you have a multiple account, which is connected to a root account, which is called AWS organization. Second one is, when you're talking about Azure, we have multiple tenant, which is connected to a root tenant. And our main motive is to compromise this root tenant. And third one is GCP. GCP is worked on project level. So you can see here, when you're talking about GCP, similar like Azure, we are using Active Directory, Azure Active Directory for authentication. Here in GCP, we are using Cloud Identity as well as Google Workspace for authentication. So initially, suppose if you are using mail services, if you are using Drive, you have to go for this Google Workspace. Before that, it said G Suite. Now it's going Google Workspace. So this is used for both authentication as well as your SaaS application. But recently they introduced Cloud Identity. It is similar like Azure AD. So this is used for authentication and authorization. So suppose if you are using Google Cloud to host your resource or to spin your resource to host your applications, at the backend, Google Cloud can use Cloud Identity as well as Workspace for authentication and authorization. And this is really important, because when you do red team operation, your main motive is not just compromise the resources, which is part of Google Cloud. Your main motive is to literally move from this cloud to Google Workspace, because we have access on email or sensitive information, which is stored there. So this is how, typically it's look like. This is the typical architecture diagram of GCP. Okay, so next is multiple, so when we discuss about AWS, it's work on account level. When we discuss about Azure, it's work on tenant level. But when we discuss about GCP, it's work on project level. So each and every organization have a multiple project, just like they do have multiple tenants, they do have a multiple accounts, similar like they do have a multiple projects in GCP. One project for their development, another project for restaging, and they do have a separate project for their production environment. So suppose there is one identity. Identity can say a red teamers or a users, if they compromised, or if they want to see in the top view, they can access a multiple things. So suppose if there is organizations, organization can have a multiple projects which is associated with there. There may be possibility that they don't have an organization, but they can have a multiple project. So one identity can have part of organizations, and organization have multiple projects. I'll show you in a practical way how it's look like, what other things are there. But this is the basic idea about how AWS, Azure, and GCP separate or difference between these of three vendors. And we can have a multiple project along with this one. So project is basically a boundary, you can say. So suppose if I'm a user, I'm accessing one project, I can access this project only until or unless I want to specify to explicitly specify to another project. So this is how this architecture look like. And this will help to perform our red team operations. Why? Because from a red team perspective, our objective is to not just compromise the one account, or not just compromise to one EC2 instance or one container instance. Our motive is to make a more impactful. And how you can make it more impactful? So if you compromise all the root accounts, all the tenant, all the projects, which is part of your organization. So you can see here, this is a single project. Suppose if you have a one project, or if you have a one organization, this is the architecture look like. So you have organizations, maybe abc.com, and then you have multiple folders. Each folder have a multiple projects, and projects have the resources. Just like when we're talking about Azure, we do have a subscription. Subscription have a resource group, and then we have a resources. Similar like in GCP, we have a project, and projects have a resources. So whatever resources like a compute instance, virtual machines, storage, and all these things. So these is the typical structure of GCP project level. Let's move to the next one. Okay. So basically, now it's we discuss about AWS, Azure, and GCP, how it's typically look like from an attacker perspective or from a top level perspective. Now, when we combine all these three or four, three means three cloud vendors as well as on premises, how it's look like. So you can see here, it's very clear. Suppose there is one organization here, which is using basically Active Directory environment for their own premises, in their own premises, for all the authentication and access management part. How they are connected to AWS, Azure, or GCP. So when you're talking about network-wise connection, so suppose if you have two machines, two instances, or three instances, one is running in AWS, second one is running in Azure, third one in GCP, and there is one more machine which is running there in on-premises environment. How we can communicate to all these three vendors. So this can be done by the network connectivity. So if you have a site-to-site VPN between these, here as well, site-to-site VPN allow you to access the resources in different locations. And this will also help red teamers to literally move from one cloud to another cloud or on-premises to cloud or cloud to on-premises. So suppose this is the employee, or a user, this is part of Active Directory environment, which have access on workstation, which is assigned to you. So you can access Active Directory environment through here. But if you want to access any resources, there should be a site-to-site VPN connectivity between AWS and on-premises, as well as Azure on-premises and GCP and on-premises. So as well as cloud also have. So suppose there is a multiple cloud architecture here. If you want to access from AWS to Azure, there should be a site-to-site VPN connectivity. Most of the organizations, to access the resources, they do have a site-to-site VPN connectivity, which is generally used to communicate from one cloud vendor or from on-premises to multi-cloud things. So this is the typical architecture when we're talking about accessing the resources. Here we are discussing about network connectivity. Network connectivity can only be done by site-to-site VPN. It's really important when you have most of the organization, they do have a data center in their own premises, and either they want to migrate or they want to communicate with the cloud, so they are using this site-to-site VPN activities. And there may be a difference, just like gateway, or we can say a different services provided by each and every vendor, but mostly they are using site-to-site VPN to access this thing. So if you're performing a red team operation, you should understand about how we can literally move from one cloud to another cloud when there is a connectivity between both the cloud or connectivity between on-premises and cloud. So this is, we discuss about network connectivity. What about identity? You can see here. Yeah. So identity means how, suppose there is one employee, which is part of organizations. I can access Active Directory environment. But if I want to access the Azure and GCP, so there are two ways. One is I need to create basically I am user in AWS, and then I have to use a separate credential for accessing AWS. Similar like Azure and same applied on GCP as well. So I have to keep separate credential for each and every cloud vendor. But now there is one, most of the organization, they are using federation, identity federation. So identity federation will help you to use a single credential, which is your Active Directory credential, to access the cloud resources, with respect of what cloud you have. So either you can access the resources on AWS, Azure, and GCP, and that is really, really important. But from a red team perspective, this is a very important. Why? Because initially what happened, if you're doing red team assessment, and if you found that you get the credential, only you can access the Active Directory or on-premises. You cannot access AWS. Because for accessing the AWS, we have to use a separate credential. For Azure, we have to use a separate credential. But now, if you compromise the user, which have federation, so each and every user definitely have a federate identity, but you have to identify the what kind of access they do have in AWS, Azure, and GCP. So if you compromise that user, you can directly access the, you know, Azure, AWS, and GCP without, you know, compromising the other credentials, because this user have rights and you need to use only the single credential to access this one. So this is how federation identity look like. When we're talking about connectivity between on-premises and cloud, federation identity will help. Even cloud to cloud vendor, suppose you have you setting up identity in Azure AD, and if you want to federate to AWS and GCP, you can do that. I'll show you how it's actually look like. And this is the typical architecture. We have one user. You can see here, it's very clear. We have one user, which have only single credentials, which is Active Directory credentials. Now, when you're talking about AWS, it's a root account, and root account can access a multiple, you know, resources. So as a red teamer, your main objective is to reach this level. So you can access the root account of AWS, you can access the primary account for Azure, and you can access the root or organization account to GCP. So if you have access on all these three, this one, and this one, you can access all the tenant, you can access all the account, and you can access all the projects, which is part of this. So our main objective is to achieve in this level. So there may be a global administrator for Azure, there may be organization administrator for GCP, and root an account for AWS. So we have to, our main motive to achieve is this level. So you can access, you can compromise all the, you know, organizations, because now you can access each and everything which is part of AWS, Azure, and GCP. Okay, so that's, we discuss about how it's typically look like. Now we are talking about basically authenticate. So generally what happens, there are multiple ways to authenticate each and every, you know, cloud or on-premises. But when we're talking about the top level, there are only three ways to authenticate. One is you can authenticate with portal. Second one is you have to authenticate with programmatically. So only two ways are there to authenticate to cloud or multi-cloud environment. So when we're talking about portal, suppose, let's see. Okay, let's see here how it's typically look like. You can see here, this is the overview of AWS. Okay. So basically how AWS environment is look like. You can authenticate with GUI. So you can access the portal.aws.amazon.com. You have to provide two type of credential. One is your IAM credential, or maybe your SSO or federation credentials. Second one is you can directly authenticate to control plane. So there are three ways. One is data plane. This is called GUI. This is called control plane, and this is called data plane. So you can only access GUI as well as control plane. If you want to authenticate to GUI, suppose portal, you can authenticate with credentials. If you want to authenticate to control plane, you have to authenticate either CLI or SDK. When you're talking about authentications to control plane, there are two ways to authenticate. One is you can use long-term access key, and second one is you can use short-term access key. So this is typical how its authentication works. Let me show you a demo. Okay, suppose this is my attacker machine, and how I can authenticate to AWS. The first thing is I'm going to authenticate to AWS here. Yeah, you can access the portal aws.amazon.com. And this is how you can authenticate. So suppose I'm using the root credential or compromised account. I'm using the root account here. I can authenticate here. So this account is part of IAM user. That's why you can directly authenticating here. But what about if it's a federation identity is there? Let me show you how it's done. Okay, so you can see here, I'm able to authenticate this from this AWS portal. And what happened, right now I am user to authenticate this particular portal. But what about if you are using federation? So generally what happened, if you are using federation, you have to authenticate a different way. So here, AWS provider, AWS SSO. SSO means if you are using identity, which is not part of AWS, suppose you are using Azure identity or Active Directory identity, you can sync your identity to AWS SSO, or you can federate the identity and then you can access it. So here I use portal aws.amazon.com to authenticate, where I specify AWS I am user. But what about the federation identity? So suppose I'm part of a Active Directory environment, I'm using the same identity. How can I authenticate here? So you can see here. So each and every organization have a separate SSO URL associated with this thing. And which is start from the organization name and then awsapps.com. Oh, I'm already authenticated. Let me log out from here. Then you have a better idea about. So here you can see I used my I am user to authenticate this one, and this is a portal. But what about others? So this is my organizations. Let's start. Okay. So basically how this typically look like. So suppose if you are going to federate or you access the most of the organization, they will follow it. If you want to access AWS account with federated identity, identity which is not part of AWS IAM, identity which is maybe a Azure identity or Active Directory identity, how you can authenticate. So this is the, this URL will be the same, and this is the organization. So when organizations set up a SSO, they have to specify one a subdomain, and you can authenticate. Suppose for my organization, Atomic Nuclear, have the federations with this one. So you can see here, if I'm going to authenticate with this one, how it's typically look like. So what is happening in the background, I'm using here is a Azure as a federated identity. Let me log out from the Azure, then only you can see. I'll log out from here as well. Okay, so you can see here, very simple. When you are going to authenticate with I am user, you can use portal dot or your console dot or aws dot amazon.com. If you have a I am user, you can authenticate. You have to specify your credentials. If it's I am user, you have to specify the account ID and then you can authenticate. But what about federation? So here, this is the federation URL which is belongs to my organization. Let me see here. This is the federation URL or SSO URL, which is belongs to AWS. And from identity federation, I'm using Active Directory here. So what happened? If you authenticate here, it will redirect me to the Azure Active Directory or Azure portal. I logged in there and then I can access AWS resources. So you can see here, it's been redirected to me to Azure portal. I have to specify the credentials. And now I'm able to access the account which is belongs to me. Why this is important? Suppose if you compromise a user, or federation user, which have or you compromise from the Azure side, you compromise a user on Active Directory or Azure Active Directory, And you have only single credential. So using federation identity, you can access all the accounts which is belongs to this particular user. So you can see here, this user have only single account access in AWS. And these are the roles which is defined there. So in our subsequent section, we will discuss in detailed how it's happened, what is look like. And you can see, I don't have a credentials of AWS, but still I'm logged into the AWS account. So this is how a federation identity really help, or from a red team perspective, it's very impactful for an organization. So this is how you can see here, I'm able to access the portal. So we discuss about if you're accessing the GUI, either you have to specify IAM user or SSO, similar kind of work on, so if you are going to authenticate with CLI, or programmatically, you have to authenticate to the control plane. And there are each and every cloud vendors, they will follow two things. Either you have a short-term access key or you have a long-term access key. From red team perspective, why it's really important, because if you have a short-term access key, you can access the resources or you can authenticate to the particular cloud vendor on a short-term basically. And it will be expire after a certain time period. So you have to identify the way to laterally move or escalate your privilege, or how you can access from short-term access key to the long-term access key. Long-term access key will be valid for a lifetime, or for certain, which is more than the short-term access key, and then you can access the cloud vendor. So this is how typically each and every cloud vendor look like. Even AWS, Azure, and GCP, this is the way they work. Okay, so this is how it's look like. So if you want to access from IAM user, you have to use this following URL. If it's a federation credential, you have to use this URL. This is belongs to my organization, but for your organization, it may be a different. The first part may be a different. Maybe you have abc.awsapps.com to access the federation URL. And to access the programmatically, you have to use a long-term access key, or you have to use a short-term access key. So I have a limited time here. So let's go to Azure. Now, we discuss about AWS, how it look like Azure. So Azure also follow the same thing. So all the cloud vendor follow the same thing. We have a GUI, we have a control plane, and we have a data plane. GUI means the portal access. So Azure, just like if you are accessing a resource, you can go for a portal.azure.com. But if you directly access a services, suppose you want to spawn any computer instance or virtual machine there, you can use CLI or API to authenticate this particular thing. This will also follow the same techniques. You have two kind of tokens. One is short term and second one is long term. So let me see how it's look like for our case. Suppose I'm going to load, and this is how it's look like if you are authenticate to using federations. Suppose if you are going to access with portal.azure.com, basically you can access Azure Active Directory as well as Azure ERM. So this is the typical structure of Azure Active Directory. So you have to use this one to access all the part of Azure Active Directory. If you want to access Azure ERM, so all other services which is part of Azure ERM, and you can see the subscriptions and all this thing will be there. But so there is no subscription with this particular user. So you can see here, this user can have multiple tenant access. Here it can only access this particular tenant, but you can see here, this can access only single tenant or single directory, but there may be multiple tenant associated with this user, or this user can access multiple tenants. But what about Office 365? Azure Active Directory, you can access directly from here. But if you want to access the Office 365, you have to go to portal.office.com. So there, if you have admin access, you can access it, you can see here. Whatever subscriptions I have, maybe you have subscriptions for threat management, or maybe, Office Outlook and all these things. So suppose if you are using Outlook on the web, So you can sign it here. Why it's really important? Because suppose if you compromise the Azure account, you can access the mail which is belongs to this particular user. I'm gonna specify here. You can see here. Access the mail which is belongs to this particular user. Oh, because it's not configured yet. So if you can configure it with Office 365, you can access the mail or OneDrive or Exchange, which is belongs to Office 365. So this is how this typical, you know, look like. So we can see here, I am going to authenticate with this portal. So you can use the credential which is belong to Azure Active Directory or Federation credential. The portal, the URL will be the same, portal.azure.com. There is one more thing. Azure also provide basically we can say single SSO kind of thing. So suppose I'm accessing this particular URL, myapp.microsoft.com from here. Let me close this one as well. My apps, I think. So here I'm going to authenticate with Federation user or federated user. You can see here. I'm authenticate to Azure with a federated user identity, and I can see I can access AWS and GCP as well from here directly. This is really important when you're performing a red team operation, and you can see, okay, I have only access to Azure, but what about Azure? What about AWS and GCP? How can I access them? So you can access directly from here. So you can access the AWS or you can access the GCP directly from here without entering the credential. So this will help. Yeah. You can see it will take some time, and you can see here I'm accessing the GCP portal with the same without entering the credentials, and I can access the AWS portal as well. So this is really, really important. Federation identity is really, you know, helpful for a red teamers to compromise whole the environment without entering, without even knowing the credential of AWS and GCP. I'm able to access the full account. So this is really helpful for performing a red team operation. So this, I'm just giving a basic idea about how typical organizations, the architectures or the network architectures they do have, how they connected to each other. So you can see a portal, Azure is connected to AWS and AWS and GCP in terms of identity. So you can access whatever resources you compromise in Azure, or what users might have in Azure, you can access the same thing on GCP and AWS as well. Okay, so this is how I can access it. I don't have much time here, but in our subsequent section, we'll discuss about how actually the things happen, what is actually happening in the background, how we can authenticate with CLI. Right now, I have access on the portal, but what about if I don't have access on the portal? How we can laterally move from CLI to the portal access, or how even using access with CLI, how we can access all the resources with this federation identity. So these are the commands. I don't have much time here. Now, talking about GCP, how typically GCPs look like? Same kind of situation. GCP also have a portal, console.cloud.google.com. They do have a backend control plane for their APIs, and they do have actual services or the storage or VMs which is there. To access the portal, say like we can go for it. Suppose how I can access the GCP, you can see here, just log out from here. GCP also I'm going to log out. So you can see here from Federation identity, I can log out from here. Let me sign it out from here. You have to enter this one. console.cloud.google.com. Now, suppose I'm using this user's credentials to authenticate to this one. So I just specify the username and then password. And here I go. So I can authenticate to the cloud. Here you can see this is the really important thing here. You can see here, I can access this project, my first project, as well as what is the project it belongs to. So you can see here it belongs to this particular. One second, it's taking some time to load. One second. So you can access, you can see here there are two things. One is a project and one is the organization. So organization is on top of level and we have access on multiple projects. This user can access only this project, which is part of this organization. So there may be chance that there is no organization, but there are multiple projects. There may be possibility that there are organization as well as there are multiple projects. But this is totally depend upon what access this particular user have. So here I access through I am user of GCP. What about federated? How I can access with the federated user? So simply you have to run it from here. And you have to go for a console.cloud.com again. At this time, this user, Manish user, is a part of Google Cloud itself. Google Cloud IAM user. But I need a user which is a federated user, which doesn't have identity in Google Cloud, but which have identity in Azure. So suppose let's authenticate with different user. The same user, I authenticate to Azure. EMP01. Sorry. Yeah, dot site. Yeah, so you can see here I'm authenticated to console dot you know cloud.google.com, but it will redirect me to the federated identity. So here also I'm using the Azure Active Directory as a federated identity. So you can see here it's redirect to me a different way. I authenticate here and I can access Google Cloud Console while entering the credential of Azure Active Directory. Yeah, you can see here it's authenticate here and then redirect to me to this console.cloud.com. Same kind of things you can see here. I can access the project. So whatever project I can access it. Okay, one second. It's taking some time, one second. Yeah, so you can see here there's organizations. Is there or not for this particular user? Yes, you can see there is organization, but there is no project. So when you're doing red team assessment, you will find that a user which have a multiple project access and the user which doesn't have any access on this thing, but still you can access the portal. So this is how AWS Azure and GCP work like. Active Directory environment, we already know that how we can authenticate. So I'm not going to discuss here. Yeah, you can authenticate with this one. So this is the Active Directory environment. Just a brief. So suppose if you have Active Directory environment, then you have a domain controller, you have a workstation. So there are two kinds of account. One is domain account, which can be a user account or computer account. And there will be a one local account. Local means you can, which is not a part of domain, but this is a local administrator role, any local account which is on this workstation. So it's worked on the three way. One is either you have your credentials, username, password, you have a NTLM hashes, and or maybe you can have a Kerberos ticket. So if you have any of these things, you can authenticate to the environment. And so it depends upon what kind of credentials you have, and what, there are multiple ways, or there are different ways to authenticate this one. So this is a typically look like. You need these kind of credentials. So that's all about just a basic introduction. But in our subsequent section, we'll discuss in detail what is the difference between short term and long term, how we can use CLI, how we can laterally movement, and what kind of attacks is belongs to each and every cloud vendors or Active Directory environment. So we are going to, there is one training that we are going to release, which is, so we have two kind of way. So I'll show you how it's look like. So we will discuss about overview of multi-cloud, how IAM work, then we'll discuss about AWS, especially how federation identity work, how IAM work, what is the difference. So I'll share this the table of content with you. I think I don't have much time here, but first thing is the basic introduction. Second one is attack. So what kind of attacks are there? Each and every cloud vendors, OSINT, initial access, privilege escalation, how we can perform. Then objectives. So our main objective is to compromise multiple cloud vendors, AWS, Azure, and GCP, and laterally move from on-premises as well as compromise on-premises and laterally move to the cloud and then compromise whole cloud environment. This is the objective. So we have a lab, this is the lab architecture look like, which is similar like a real world enterprise environment. They are using multiple services. They do have a federated identity. They do have a GitHub. They do have a LinkedIn, all these things. And they do have on-premises as well. So how we can approach, how we can laterally move, how we can compromise. So your main objective as the attackers to compromise the whole environment, which is belongs to organizations. So yeah, the last one is basically, we have two kind of trainings. One is the same where we discuss about from the scratch to attack side. And this is free for each and everyone. There's no course involved in this thing. This will be interactive. There's no recorded session will be there. Only interactive, which is happening on the weekend. So we will share the details. And there is one subscription plan. In subscription plan, only the difference is you will get a lab access. The lab that we showed earlier. So you will get a lab access where you can perform all the operations. And so community plan, the free one, it's already, start. Yash will share the details. But we're going to start the batch from next week. 15th of January, and from the premium, you can go for it. If you found it's really interesting, it's really helpful, you can go for a premium plan. Otherwise, you can, it's your options. So thanks everyone for joining this session. If you have any query questions, please feel free to ask. We have 4 more minutes. If anybody have any query questions, please feel free to ask.
I have unmuted. If anyone have any questions, feel free to ask here, please.
If nobody have any questions, I think we can. We have 3 more minutes still. If you have a query, questions regarding our community plan. So this plan is free for everyone, where we'll discuss about each and every cloud vendors, the lateral movement, different attack techniques, how you can perform a red team operation using manual or automated tools.
So this is Raghu here. After we take the subscription plan, the lab is only available for 30 days, if I'm not wrong.
Yes, exactly. So basically, lab is look like a real world environment, and we do have a limited capacity there. So it will be valid for only 30 days.
Okay, if this 30-day lab shall be renewed, if we wanted to use it for a longer period of time?
Yes, it can be. It can be.
And is it part of the subscription, or it has to be paid with additional charges because of the cloud usages?
Yes. So it is the additional charges will be there.
Okay, thank you.
Ryu is asking, what is the difference between the community plan and the premium plan?
Okay, so only difference is when you go into the community editions, we have interactive sessions will be there. Well, we'll discuss each and every attack, but there is no lab involvement is here. Why are we taking charging on subscription plan? Because we have to go for there are a lot of resources consumption in multiple cloud environment. So if you are going for a lab, then you could go for a subscription plan or premium edition. If you just want to see how actually attack work and just the theoretical knowledge, you can go for a community plan. We will only discuss, there is no lab involvement, but training will be the same.
Okay. Luis is asking, what is the expected price for this training?
So for premium editions, so the best thing is go for a community plan, learn about things. If you found it really helpful, it will be around less than $1,000.
Okay. And Rakesh is asking, will it be beginner friendly or need to know the concepts of a red team?
No. It will be the beginner friendly. So even if you don't have any knowledge on cloud side, no worries. We will start from the scratch. We'll see how each and every cloud vendor work, and then how we can perform different kind of attack. And at the end, we'll discuss about how we can perform a red team operations. So it's a beginner friendly.
Yeah, right. So I guess that is all for this session. And if anyone have any questions, feel free to drop us an email, okay, at info@cyberwarfare.live. I guess I have mentioned the email in the chat box. So please feel free to enroll in there. And also the community plan for this course is live now. So if anyone is interested, please go to our website and you can self check out. So it's free of cost. We are starting the training on 15th January next week, Saturday. So it will be two sessions for that, two live interactive sessions that we are delivering. And it will be live, full remote. You can interact with the instructors with us, and it will be fully remote. All right. So whatever queries or anything you have, please let us know. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks, everybody. If anybody have any query questions, please drop us a mail. And you can join our Discord channel. So yeah, that's all.
Okay. Any promo discount? Andri is asking.
So do one thing, go for a community. Then if you found useful, we'll see. Because as of now, we don't have this kind of thing. Why we release the community edition? If it's really interested, if it's helpful for you, then go for a premium one. And we don't have any promo discount as of now. Because the charging that we are taking for a lab is actually the course that we have for the different cloud vendors.
Okay. One more is asking, is how much does it overlap with your CARTS course? And can we start with community and transition to premium later?
Yes. So community is free of cost for each and everyone. If you found this useful, you can go for a subscription plan or premium edition. And when you're talking about the CARTS is mainly focused on AWS, which is in detailed depth from AWS. But here we'll discuss about three cloud vendor on the top of view, their attack, and then lateral movement and all the attacks within there. So CARTS is mainly focused on AWS in depth. Here we don't have that much of depth, but we'll give you the idea. We'll give you the lab environment only, which is connected to all the cloud vendors and on-premises.
Okay.
So if you want to learn only on the, if you want to learn specific to the AWS, go for a CARTS, which will give you much more detail. But here, because we have a time limited, we have to cover multiple cloud vendors, then it will be just overview, attack, and their teams, right?
Okay. Rohan is asking that we will be getting the training recording in the subscription plan.
No. Subscription plan. One second. Can you repeat? Yes, can you repeat it?
Subscription plan means, I guess he's asking about the premium one.
Yes, premium one, you will get a recorded session. But community one, there's no recorded session. Only the interactive classes will be there.
So the lab is really great. Anyone who is wondering about the lab, like the architecture and all this thing. So the lab is really large, and we have tried to cover a lot of attacks and new things that we have done, gone through the engagement. So we have put it on all of these things in our labs, and there are multiple challenges in the lab. And other than that, the one main catching point here is that we are also providing a SaaS platform with our premium bundle. So what is included in the SaaS platform is that we have 100 plus challenges that is focused on the hybrid cloud one, okay? The multi-cloud one. And it's like, goes from each service level to multi-cloud one, okay? So you can have 100 plus challenges pinned up under your own account, okay, in an instant. So that is really cool, and it is available for both the community edition too. However, for the community edition, it is only 10 plus challenges, and for the premium one, we have around 100 plus challenges there. So anyone who is interested, feel free to check our website with both the things like the SaaS platform we have and also that lab architecture, because that is something next level that we have done here. Okay. Where to enroll for the free community version? Rakesh, it's available on the website. So what I will do is let me share the website link. Just give me a sec. So I have just sent the link there. And who is asking? What is the difference of community material and premium? So actually, we have tried to provide as the best we can do for the community plan, right? But the premium material will have obviously a lot of new things, and it will be a complete bundle where you will be getting 500 plus pages PDF divided in three categories, okay, for each cloud and also for the hybrid cloud one. Other than that, you will be getting the SaaS platform having 100 plus challenges, and our team is continuously adding new challenges in there. Plus, you will also be getting 30 days lab access, which you can schedule as per your requirement, like as per your convenience. It will not start right away. It's based on your plan. Okay, like whenever you want, you can schedule your lab anytime within 1 year of the purchase. So that is possible, Luis. And what is the premium subscription cost? So as said by Manisha, that it is less than $1,000, right? And like we will be enrolling, we will starting enrolling the batch from next month, I guess, for the premium subscription plan. And the batch will start from 15th March there. So it will be fully remote. And then we have more than 4 or 6 sessions that we are still not confirmed, but there will be 4 or 6 sessions. Each session will have approx 4 hours. Okay. So there will be all live, all remote. Okay. So whatever things you have, you can directly interact with the instructors, and these problems, solutions, all these things will be cleared by us. Jane. So hope you all like the session, okay, this short webinar that we have done for this. And what we suggest is to please check out our free community version, right, to know about what we will teach, like the overview of the labs and the training material, the quality of training material and all these things. So check out first with this and then to go for the premium subscription. Right. So please feel free to share the feedback on social media, right, on LinkedIn, Twitter, wherever you are active. So please feel free to share it and tag us. So that will help us a lot. If anyone have any questions, please let us know as we will end this webinar. Vivek is asking how we will join the training after enrolling to community edition. Actually, we will be rolling out the links soon, okay, since the batch for the community will start from 15 January. Okay, so it will be a 2 hour session. Okay, so whole session will be two sessions and each having 2 hours, okay, duration there. So we will be enrolling as soon as you enroll to our dedicated portal. So you will be getting the links soon, okay, before 15 January, of course, right? And the classes will basically be on weekends, okay? So as soon as you enroll, it's free of cost. So as soon as you enroll, you will get to know the portals, and in the portal we will add the details like the links to join and all these things will be in there. So please enroll there for the community plan.
Oh, Yash, I think we can wrap up this session.
Okay. Fine.
Okay. Thanks, everybody. Thanks to join the sessions. If you have any query questions, feel free to ask on Discord or either via mail.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you.